The Justice Department on Wednesday named former FBI Director Robert Mueller as special counsel to investigate possible collusion between the Trump campaign and Russia. Can a sitting president be prosecuted? Can a sitting president be thrown in prison? Or is impeachment our only hope for removing Trump? For more on this, we're going to be joined in Washington, D.C. by Dylan Matthews, who writes for Vox. But first, a few words about Vox. Vox was set up 3 years ago by Ezra Klein, who left the Washington Post, to basically do over at Vox what he was doing over at the Washington Post, and that is to explain the news. Vox.com explains the news. The explainers at Vox are essential. Great, clear, concise writing. Vox, I cannot recommend Vox enough. If you see something in the news, you don't understand it, go to Vox.com. Vox.com understands that most people see every news story as a soap opera that they're watching for the first time. And from what I have been able to see over at Vox is that Ezra Klein and his staff, they get that everyone, including the experts, everyone, we're all flying on instruments. We can't remember how we got there, and that's why Vox is so great. It lets you feel okay for not knowing anything. Welcome to the show, Dylan Matthews.
Great to be here, and that's, I think, the best and most complimentary description of what we do that I've ever heard, so thank you for that.
Well, I mean it, and that's kind of been the mission statement of this show, is I have children, and I've always been trying to explain to them the news. I always wanted to sit with them and watch the New York Times, go over the New York Times, and my father used to explain to me how to read the New York Times and how we got to where we're at. Because you really can't understand a news story unless you put it in context. And Ezra Klein, I would assume, is in his 30s and talked to people his age and younger. And they're lost because there's a shorthand. I'm getting angry. There's a shorthand. This makes me really angry. People use a shorthand not to inform, but to exclude, to make themselves sound smarter. It's why Mass used to be delivered in Latin. Thank you for joining us. We're done. Thank you.
That was quick, but yeah, no, we try to make things accessible, and yeah, that I think a lot of that is people writing this inverted pyramid format and news stories that made a lot of sense for print newspapers, since you needed something where you could cut off the end if you absolutely needed to for regional papers and the like. And it doesn't make as much sense online, and so we're trying to play around with some new ways of presenting the news and trying to put it in more context. So I'm glad you're a fan.
I'm a fan. You know, I go to The Intercept for great investigative reporting, and I go to Vox to understand what I just read.
Which is The Intercept does really great work.
Yeah, there's a very exciting new media happening. I think Vox, we have to talk about Robert Mueller, but I think Vox changed the New York Times. I think Vox single-handedly changed the New York Times. The New York Times is my Bible, as is the Washington Post. But I've noticed that the New York Times, since Vox got it, that most of us don't get it, and we need to be told what happened and how we got there. Okay, we're going to talk about that was me clapping my hands out of excitement. We're going to talk to Dylan about whether or not a president can be prosecuted in a second. But case in point, since we set up the interview yesterday, you wrote a piece for Vox entitled, and I love this, 9 Questions About Watergate You're Too Embarrassed to Ask. And that's such a great example of the public service Vox.com provides, V-O-X. .com provides, not just for millennials who only heard about Watergate, but for aging baby boomers like me who lived through Watergate and can't remember a damn thing. So the news is happening really fast. Is it faster than Watergate?
It certainly seems that way, and it certainly seems to be having really negative repercussions for Trump faster than Watergate. I think one of the remarkable things for someone like me who didn't live through it and is sort of reading about it as history is that in the midst of the beginnings of the scandal, that after the actual Watergate break-in, after people were arrested with ties to his campaign, he won the biggest victory in modern American history in the 1972 presidential election. Mm-hmm. He seemed unscathed, and it really wasn't until almost a year after the initial break-in that things started to escalate. The Senate set up a committee to investigate the matter. A special prosecutor was appointed. And it was kind of a slow burn, and from there it took another year or so until sort of things got to a point where it was clear that Nixon had tried to interfere with the FBI investigation, which was sort of the smoking gun that led a group of Republicans to go to the White House and say, your presidency is over. And it's really remarkable to me now that we have this memo that James Comey wrote saying that the president asked him to scuttle an FBI investigation, that it's a pretty close parallel to a very late development in Watergate that sort of sealed the deal in a lot of ways. It does seem to be going a lot faster.
Right. Could Nixon have been prosecuted for obstruction of justice? I know that some of the articles of impeachment were about obstruction of justice, but was Archibald Cox, who was a special prosecutor who was fired, could they have pursued obstruction of justice? That's what you wrote about.
Right. So the conclusion that Cox and Leon Jaworski, who succeeded him after Nixon fired Cox, came to was that the president can't be prosecuted outside the impeachment process while he's in office. They were absolutely of the view, and I think it is sort of uncontroversial among legal scholars, that the president can be prosecuted for crimes committed as president once he leaves office. So there was a really real possibility after Nixon resigned that Jaworski or another prosecutor would file charges against him now that he was sort of lost presidential immunity in their view. That was rendered moot after Gerald Ford pardoned Nixon and effectively made it impossible to prosecute him for any Watergate-related wrongdoing. But that was the view of the special prosecutor. It was the view of the Justice Department. The Justice Department looked into it again in the late 90s during the Clinton impeachment scandal, when this sort of became a newly relevant question, and came to the same conclusion that the president is immune from prosecution by normal federal prosecutors until he leaves office.
But I do remember Clinton was deposed in the Paula Jones lawsuit, which was a civil suit. How was that different than special prosecutor or special counsel?
So as you say, the difference comes down to a distinction between civil and criminal proceedings that I think the conclusion that the Supreme Court came to in Clinton v. Jones, the ultimate case they held about whether or not the president was immune from civil suits, was there's nothing in the Constitution precluding it, and it wouldn't cause an undue burden to the functioning of the presidency, that it had already been established in Watergate that you could make the president testify or give up documents and sort of do the same sort of thing as that. And if the court ruled against him, then the most that would happen is he would have to pay some money. And I think the argument by people who say that you can't do a criminal prosecution is that that's just a whole other ball of wax, that you might be able to be president even as you're paying off a legal settlement to someone. You can't be president from prison.
Can't be president.
From prison, yeah. That's the argument. And I should say that this is not uncontroversial, that this is the prevailing view that the Justice Department has adopted. It's the view of a lot of lawyers. The Supreme Court hasn't ruled on this, and there are law professors who read the law differently and think that it would be totally legitimate. In practice, it's hard, that a lot of the crimes a president could conceivably commit and the crimes that are being discussed in Trump's case are federal crimes, and the entire federal law enforcement apparatus, including the special prosecutor, are serving at the pleasure of the president. So if a normal federal prosecutor, like the U.S. attorney for D.C., say, indicts Trump, Trump could just fire them, and that would solve the issue for him.
Get ready, folks. We're going to talk about the 1819 Supreme Court ruling, McCulloch versus Maryland. But as an explainer, O.J., so people understand the difference between a criminal prosecution and a civil prosecution. Talk to me as though Trump were O.J.
Right.
Which is unfair to O.J.
I suppose. I just finished the great new documentary about O.J. last night, so this is a timely entry.
Uh-huh.
So So in a criminal case, there's a different standard of proof. So let's say the Trump, sort of as he's threatened to do sometimes, goes to the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoots someone and sort of sees what happens. So the district attorney for Manhattan could indict him for murder. And then, as anyone who's seen Law and Order could tell you, you have to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that he committed it. If they're found guilty, you're subject to prison and other criminal penalties. That's a pretty high bar of proof. It was one that the jury in the O.J. Simpson case didn't think they met. In a civil suit, there is a lower burden of proof. So the jury, when the Goldman family sued O.J. after the criminal trial for wrongful death, they just had to prove that the preponderance of evidence, that sort of 51% of the evidence in the case, indicated that he had done it. And then if the jury came to that conclusion, which it also doesn't have to come to unanimously the way a jury in a criminal trial in most states does, then they can decide on punitive damages and sort of additional damages from there, which would all be monetary. So I think the reading of the law that the Justice Department subscribes to is that someone could sue Trump for wrongdoing and it could go through the federal courts and wouldn't necessarily be tossed out of court just because he's the president. And
did you just say that the reading of the law is from the Justice Department's Office of Legal Counsel? Is that their interpretation of it? Is that what you just said?
Right. So they're the people who think that the president is criminally immune. The Supreme Court has actually ruled that he's not civilly immune. So that's a sort of uncontroversial.
Difference between criminal and civil.
Criminal, you're being prosecuted by a government agency, a prosecutor's office. If you're found guilty, you can go to prison or charged a fine. Civil, you're being sued by another private actor, typically. So say the family of someone you killed in the case of O.J.
The difference between criminal and civil. That's important for readers and listeners to know. It just is, and it's just bandied about as though we're supposed to know that difference. Trump University, before Trump got Obama's chair, he was being sued for Trump University. Was that a criminal suit or a civil suit?
That was a civil suit. So mm-hmm. He was not being prosecuted. He was being sued by the New York State Attorney General's office.
He was being sued by the New York State Attorney General's office. So that is a state government not prosecuting criminally, but in a civil court, going to a civil court.
Right.
Was it Schneiderman? Is that who it was?
Schneiderman, yeah.
The state attorney general can go into a civil court, or you and I, as civilians, can go into a civil court and sue somebody for damages.
That's right. So right. Use the example of Obamacare. A lot of Republican states sued President Obama and the federal government for implementing Obamacare because they considered it to impinge on the rights of states. Simultaneously, some Catholic groups and Hobby Lobby sued on religious freedom grounds as individuals. Mm-hmm. And they were the same kind of case because in each case it was an actor saying that this law had violated their rights and that they needed a remedy. But it was different kinds of actors bringing that claim.
You know why I love talking to you? Because I can enjoy my stupidity.
I mean, there's a real difference between stupidity and ignorance, and I think the latter is much more common and much more acceptable. Like, I'm very ignorant about physics and most sports, and I don't think that's a sign that there's, like, something wrong with my brain. I think there's a complicated world out there, and you can only know so many things about it.
Right. Now, you're not a lawyer, right?
I'm not a lawyer. I just play one on the internet.
Okay. You present some scenarios over at Vox on how to get rid of Trump. And by the way, I'm partisan. You're not. Vox is not partisan. It's been accused of having a left-wing slant only because it remembers history.
If we try.
Yeah. So you paint some scenarios. You say that the federal prosecutors are going to have more difficulty than state prosecutors bringing a criminal case against Donald Trump. Why does the chain of command make it so difficult for federal prosecutors to go after Trump?
federal prosecutors, as a rule, are part of the Justice Department. And the Justice Department is an executive cabinet agency run by a presidential appointee whose members serve at the pleasure of the president.
And who runs the Justice Department? Who runs the Justice Department?
So it's currently run by Jeff Sessions, who is the Attorney General,
right,
who is a big Trump loyalist. Sessions has recused himself from this particular case. And so now Rod Rosenstein, who's the Deputy Attorney General, serves as acting Attorney General on cases involving Trump and Russia.
Who is Robert Mueller? Who appointed him? And who does he answer to?
So Robert Mueller served for about 12 years as FBI director in the George W. Bush and Obama administrations. Prior to that, he was a career federal prosecutor with a pretty good reputation. He was just appointed by Rod Rosenstein, the Deputy Attorney General, in his capacity as acting Attorney General on matters concerning Trump and Russia. And he is going to be what's known as a special counsel. So a special counsel is an independent person who is brought in by the Attorney General or the Justice Department to investigate a case that, for whatever reason, the department doesn't feel like it can impartially investigate on its own.
Okay, he's a special counsel. Ultimately, who is his boss?
Ultimately, his boss is Rosenstein. So,
and who is Rosenstein's boss?
Rosenstein's boss is Sessions, and Sessions' boss is Trump.
Can Trump fire a special counsel?
He absolutely can, and Richard Nixon did.
Or was Archibald Cox a special prosecutor?
So the terminology gets confused here. So Cox was appointed under the same statute that Mueller has been appointed under. After Watergate, there was a different law that was in effect for a couple of decades, known as the Independent Counsel Law, that set up a system for appointing prosecutors who were not just accountable to the Department of Justice, but were also accountable to a panel of judges so they could be more independent. That was the system through which Iran-Contra was investigated, and it was the system that saw Kenneth Starr appointed as independent counsel to investigate Bill Clinton. And people, I think, were so exhausted after the Bill Clinton saga that the law authorizing that position was let lapse.
During Watergate, John Mitchell, Attorney General, or whomever, they appointed a special counsel who was Archibald Cox, and he was investigating Watergate. He was a special counsel, not a special prosecutor, correct?
I think special counsel and special prosecutor you can use interchangeably in this case.
Okay, great. After Watergate, to avoid, was it the Saturday Night Massacre? What was it called when they fired?
The Saturday Night Massacre. So, and that was, just so people know, when Nixon was upset with what Cox was doing and ordered Elliot Richardson, who was the Attorney General, to fire him. Richardson refused and resigned. Richardson's deputy refused and resigned, and it came to the number three person in the Justice Department to actually carry out the order.
Was that Robert Bork?
It was Robert Bork, who was later appointed to the Supreme Court by Ronald Reagan and lost Senate confirmation.
Probably because of that and other things. Okay, so after Watergate, just to review, after Watergate, Congress passed a law that created something called the special prosecutor, correct?
Independent counsel.
An right. Independent counsel. And Kenneth Starr, who tormented Clinton, was operating under this new special independent counsel law. As I remember, Janet Reno was the Attorney General under Clinton. You say there was a three-judge panel that had to, what, approve the appointment of a special prosecutor? How did that law work? And it no longer exists because it was like Torquemada.
Right.
But how did Kenneth Starr work? And it seems like he had a lot more freedom than, say, Archibald Cox or Mueller's going to have.
Right. So under the law, you can only remove independent counsel for cause. That Janet Reno could fire the independent counsel, but she couldn't do it for whatever reason she wanted to. She had to prove that they had misacted and show that. And if the counsel had been terminated and they didn't think it was her cause, they could sue her and overturn it. Additionally, there was a three-judge panel, which in that case was run by some Republican appointees on the D.C. Circuit, that also oversaw Star and actually replaced Star's predecessor, who they didn't think was aggressive enough, and replaced him with Star.
I think it was Fitch or Hitch or something.
Yeah, something like that.
Something like that. Okay. Can you give me 7 more minutes?
Absolutely.
Okay, great. Mueller is over at the Justice Department. He's the special counsel, FBI head for almost a decade. Very respected. It is conceivable that Donald Trump will fire him. We're learning that Jared Kushner is whispering in Trump's ear just to fire everybody and be an authoritarian. A state prosecutor, Cyrus Vance Jr., son of Jimmy Carter's, I believe, State Department, Secretary of State, and Vivian Vance's grandson from I Love Lucy. Did you know that? I'm making that up.
Just she was Ethel.
Oh, my God. You're too young to get that reference. Knock it off. Behave yourself. Don't make me. Okay, so Cyrus Vance Jr. is not a federal prosecutor, is that correct? Or is he a federal, or is he a state prosecutor?
He's a county prosecutor. So Cyrus Vance is the prosecutor for New York County, which is the legal entity that encompasses Manhattan. Mm-hmm. So the way that prosecutors work in New York City is that each of the boroughs has their own prosecutor who's elected by people there. So there's a Brooklyn prosecutor, there's a Bronx prosecutor, there's a Staten Island prosecutor, there's a Queens prosecutor, and Cy Vance is the Manhattan prosecutor. And it's probably the most powerful local prosecutor's office in the country just because of how many people live there.
And Wall Street.
And Wall Street, and because state crimes cover a lot of really serious offenses. So murder cases in New York are all tried through the district attorney's offices.
Great. Okay, so get ready, folks, because we're about to discuss the 1819 Supreme Court ruling of McCulloch versus Maryland. All right, so Cyrus Vance Jr. decides he's going to prosecute Donald Trump for crimes. Can Donald Trump fire Cyrus Vance?
He cannot. Cyrus Vance does not serve at the pleasure of Donald Trump. He is not a federal employee. He is an elected official for New York County and can be removed. I'm not an expert on the removal procedures for municipal offices in New York, but he's accountable ultimately to the voters of Manhattan.
He decides he's going to indict Donald Trump. What could Donald Trump then claim? And here's where we get to McCulloch versus Maryland, 1819 Supreme Court ruling.
So under that ruling, which was by John Marshall, who was an early Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, who laid down a lot of sort of the foundational rulings for how the federal system of government works, basically said that the federal law trumps state law and that states can't pass laws that try to limit the behavior of the federal government.
Mm-hmm.
And so before any trial happens, what would occur in a case like that is that Trump could use his power as president to remove the case from state court to federal court. He could argue to the court that under McCulloch v. Maryland, it is unconstitutional for a local prosecutor to charge him in such a manner. And then the federal courts would have to consider that and come to rulings, and it would almost certainly be appealed by both sides, depending on who wins at the district court level and then the court of appeals level, all the way up to the Supreme Court, which would be forced to, for the first time ever, say definitively whether you can prosecute a president.
And so it's highly unlikely, because I'm thinking, what would happen if they pulled this with Obama? What would happen if Alabama tried this?
Right.
We would
be outrageous.
Right.
And I think a lot of the reason why some law professors, even some left-leaning law professors, don't think this is acceptable is because of that they think it opens the door to frivolous use of prosecutorial power to try to bring down presidents.
Before you go, Nixon was an unindicted co-conspirator. That's what he was named as during Watergate, because Jaworski, who replaced Archibald Cox, realized he couldn't indict Nixon.
That's correct.
Great. Well, thank you so much. This has just been, this is heaven for me, because It really is. You are very generous with your time, and I thank you for your hard work. And, you know, anyway, Dylan Matthews writes for Vox. Everybody should go to Vox, vox.com, and I hope you come back.
I'd love to. Thank you for having me.